Father, today we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're so grateful to be in your house. God, today, here's our hearts, Lord, open, attentive, ready to hear your word. Today, we didn't come to hear from the wisdom of man, God. We're not here to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine, God. Not here to listen to the economists, Lord, or the Wall Street Journal or anything like that, God. We don't want to hear what people have to say. We want to hear what you have to say. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives, Lord. We'll give you all the praise and all the glory for it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear. Open our hearts to be the good ground. May we be the good ground where the word is sown and may it produce fruit in each and every one of our individual lives. Today, Lord, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. We would ask today, God, that your word would go forth all around the world. Bless all the churches that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, if they're preaching your truth, God, lifting up the name of Jesus, Lord, they're our brothers and sisters, and we bless them, God. Bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Bless Calvary Chapels, God, and the Assemblies of God, and Lord, the Church of God in Christ, Lord, all the great churches that are out there, Lord, they're Catholic brothers and sisters, and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord, if they're preaching your truth, lifting up your name, God, we bless them. Also, Lord, bless the persecuted church scattered abroad throughout the world, Lord. We ask that you would comfort them, encourage them, God, heal them, bless them, and deliver them to the glory of God. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say, amen. Amen. Well, today, as you're having a seat, get your Bibles out and go with me to Matthew, the 6th chapter. Matthew chapter number 6. This is Get It Together, part number 3. We've been in a finance series called Get It Together. This is part number 3, and I want to just remind you of a couple of things that we've already covered in this series. First thing is this, is that in the New Testament alone, there are 2,084 verses on wealth, money, finances, and stewardship. That means that as you look through the Bible and you start to calculate out, you see that just in the Gospels alone, okay, in the Gospels dealing with the life of Jesus, just in the Gospels alone, 1/6 of the Gospels deals with wealth, money, and finance. In fact, a third of the parables that Jesus spoke, Jesus himself, this is God in the flesh, one out of every three parables that Jesus spoke had to do with stewardship, wealth, money, and finance. And when we come into the house of God and we start to say, well, wait a second, I don't want the church to bug me about my money. I don't want, you know, the preacher to talk to me about my finances. Well, wait a second. If Jesus, one out of every three things that Jesus spoke of in a parable, of 1/6 of the Gospels in 2,000 verses just in the New Testament alone on wealth, money, and finance, you want us to cut out that much of the Bible when we're talking to you? I mean, that's crazy. That would be preposterous. And for us to exclude that much of your life, because think about it, you work a minimum of your full-time 40 hours a week, and some of you business owners know you're working 60, 80 hours a week just to make money, and that you're stewarding to make sure that you have a comfortable life, to make sure that you can continue to take care of your family, to make sure that you can build the kingdom of God. And if we excluded that and only talked about salvation, only talked about the love of God, only talked about the grace of God, we would not be applying any of that to what most of you are spending most of your time on. And so we need to talk about this. We need to get into this. We need to understand what the word of the Lord has to say about wealth, money, and finances. We need to get it together in the area of our finances. You remember we had 5 things that we said we need to do in order to get it together in the area of our finances. Here they are. We need the right heart. We need to tithe. We need to stop worrying. We're going to talk about that today. Well, next week, we need to be good stewards. And then finally, we need to be generous. Matthew chapter 6, let me turn there. And in Matthew chapter number 6, Jesus is preaching his famous Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is speaking to the multitudes here in his sermon. He's covering subjects. He's blowing people's minds with his wisdom. In Matthew chapter number 6, I want to take a look at 2 verses, verse number 24 and verse number 25. Take a look at it with me. It says in Matthew chapter 6, verse number 24, it says, no one can serve two masters. Everybody say no one. No one. That means no one. That means nobody in this room, nobody outside of this room, nobody past, present, or future, no one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. So notice he says, if you love one, you're going to hate the other. No one can serve two masters. Or if you're loyal to one of the masters, you're going to despise the other masters. Now he concludes by saying this, you cannot serve God and mammon. Now, Jesus contrasts these two. He says, you cannot serve God and mammon. Some of your newer translations translate mammon as money. You cannot serve God and money. Now, that word serve there really is talking about a slave position, okay? And we understand that when we gave our hearts and lives to the Lord Jesus Christ, that we became bondservants of Christ. Is that right? You can read that all throughout your Bible. I am a bondservant of Jesus Christ. In fact, in the Old Testament, you will find under the Old Covenant, under the law, that if there was a slave, somebody who was indebted to somebody, and they served their term of what they needed to do to pay back their debt. But let's say after the end of their term, when they were supposed to be set free, they said, you know what? I really love my master. I really enjoy what I'm doing. They could become a love slave. They could become somebody who willingly lays down their life and serves their master for the rest of their days. And that's what happened to each and every one of us. The Lord Jesus Christ set us free. He set us free by his blood. And when you receive Jesus into your life, now you become a love slave. You lay down your own life to serve God Almighty. But there's a problem because there's another master that wants to master you. And it's called mammon. Is it money? Is it just paper and coins and numbers in a bank account? Or is it something else? Because notice it says that mammon wants you to serve it. In fact, mammon doesn't want you just to serve it. Mammon wants you to be enslaved to it. Mammon wants you to be a love slave, to lay down your life. See, you will either love the one and hate the other. If you love mammon, that means you're going to end up hating God. If you're loyal to mammon, then you're going to end up despising God. Wait a second, Pastor. I love God. I want to serve God. I want to lay down my life for him. And yet, if we serve mammon, the Bible says we will end up hating God and despising him with our actions. None of us want to be in that position. And yet, I would dare to say many of us in this place and many people in church world today are serving mammon rather than serving God. Today, many of you in this place don't even know it, but you are enslaved. And you're saying, well, Pastor, what do I do? See, listen, today, if you will listen, today, if you will get a hold of the principles you're about to learn, the things that God is about ready to impart and share through the Word of God, then you will be freed from the clutches of mammon. You will have freedom in Christ. You will have freedom in your finances. You will not be enslaved to another, but you will lay down your life for the Lord, and you will love God, and you will be loyal to him if you will listen up today. So important for each and every one of us. So what is mammon? What is mammon? Is mammon paper money? Is this mammon right here? I got a crisp, clean $1 bill right here in my hand. Is this mammon? Is this really what it's talking about, or is it something else? See, this is just paper. This doesn't have any power over it. It doesn't move unless I move it. It doesn't have eyes that can see. It doesn't have ears that can hear. It does not have a mouth that can speak. Even though it's got an image of those things on my buddy George over here, it cannot do anything in and of itself. If I lay it down here on the pulpit, it's not going to come over here and slap me in the face and tell me to do nothing. See, many of us have said, well, my money talks to me. It's sitting there in my pocket saying, you better spend me. Come on, somebody. But I would venture to say, see, this is just paper. They say money doesn't grow on trees. Yes, it does. It's paper, right? You can dig money up out of the ground. Copper and nickel and all that other good stuff. Gold, silver. It's just dirt. It's just wood. It's just material, natural mass, matter. This doesn't have any power in itself. This cannot speak to you, but there is a spirit attached to this called mammon. It is a demonic spirit that is resting on money that wants to speak to you. See, mammon doesn't talk to you through money. Mammon talks to you about money. Have you ever noticed that? Whenever it's talking to you, it's usually about your money, about what to do. And many times the spirit of mammon speaks a language. In fact, it speaks a couple of languages. Let me tell you what they are. The first language it speaks to you is poverty. Mammon will speak to you through the language of poverty. Here's another language it speaks. Mammon will speak to you through the language of pride. I'll give you a couple of examples of this, okay? Poverty will say to you this: save it. Save it. Don't spend that money. You don't know what's going to happen. You don't know if you'll ever have any more. You better put that in your pocket. You better put that under the mattress in the bed. You better save it. You know, the economy's going down. Things are being destroyed all over the earth. Who knows what's going to go on with the nations of the world? We just backed out of the agreement. What are they going to think of us? Everything's going to hell in a handbasket. You better save that dollar. See, that's what mammon will tell you through the voice of poverty. What does pride say? Pride says, spend it. You don't know what's going to happen. You better spend it. Things are going on around the world. See, it's the same spirit, but it's speaking different languages to you, isn't it? Pride will say, spend it. You know what pride will say? You are never going to find this deal ever again. Anybody ever had mammon speak to you and tell you that, right? You walk into the store, you're not even looking for nothing. You're just there to go and get one item in the back of the store. As you're walking towards the back of the store, what happens? You see a deal. And mammon tells you, you better get that right now because everybody else is going to buy that. And if you come back to this store tomorrow, it's going to be gone and that deal will be over and you will never have that deal ever again. Come on, somebody. You know mammon's been talking to you, right? You know what the Spirit of God says? God says, trust me. I'll show you what's ahead. That's part of the Holy Spirit's job description, is to show us things to come. If there's financial ruin up ahead, God will say, save it. If there's a good deal and God wants you to get it, God will say, spend it. God says, trust me. I'll show you what's ahead. You just be prepared to do what I tell you to do with your money. Come on. Poverty says this. You can't afford to give. You can't afford to tithe. You can't afford it. Pastor's asking you to pray about an offering at the end of the month. You can't afford it. How dare they, right? That's what poverty says. You can't afford to give. What does pride say? Pride says, you don't have to give. You don't have to get. How dare they talk to you about your money? How dare they ask you for more? You're already tithing. What do they want more now? The greedy church? What are they going to do? Line their pockets and drive the best car? What? They're trying to keep everybody else poor while they're getting rich? See, pride will talk to you. You know what God says about all this? God doesn't say save it or spend it. God doesn't say you can't afford or you don't have to. Look at what God says. God says, give what I tell you to give. Give privately and I'll reward you openly. Isn't that what the Spirit of God says? You give privately. Just do what you're called to do. You don't have to ring a bell or shout at anybody. Look what I'm doing, everybody. Woo! Here goes my dollar in the offering. God says, I don't care about your chump change. Right? You've been seen by everybody. You got your reward. There you go. Hope you liked it. Hope you enjoyed your 15 minutes of fame. Everybody's woo. Look at how great they are giving. No, God says, you give privately, I'll reward you openly. Now, what happens when you get rewarded openly? Wow, look at this. God just blessed me, right? Somebody else notices. Wow, hey, look at how God blessed you. Poverty comes and starts talking again. Oh, it's not a big deal. And we start making excuses for our blessing through poverty, right? Mammon starts talking to us about poverty. Oh, I've been rewarded. Oh, well, you know what? I got a deal. It wasn't all that big of a thing. You know, I just happened to be at the right place at the right time. No, you know, I didn't get the best one. I just got a good one. And praise God, you know. And we start making excuses for the blessings of God on our life. You know what pride says? Pride says, well, all I do is win, win, win. That's what I'm talking about. I only get the best. You better believe God's blessing me because everybody come around and look at the righteous one, right? That's what pride will say. But what does God say? God says, be grateful. Be grateful. Come on, when I reward you openly, how about you say, thank you, Jesus, right? Somebody compliments you, you say, praise God. Yeah, this is the reward of the right. This is what God does when you serve him. I'm a witness and a testimony of what God can do with somebody who's just dumb enough to obey him and just follow him, to give their tithe, to bring an offering when he says so or when I feel like it. And guess what? God will reward you too. God's no respecter of persons. God wants to bless you. See, that's the difference between the spirit of poverty and the spirit of pride. Poverty says, I can't have that. I can't have that. It's too nice. It's too much. I can't have that. You know what pride says? Pride says, I gotta have that. That's not enough. Pride will never have enough. What does God say? God says, seek me first. Seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. What does God say? What does God say, okay? God says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. You know, it's not bad to want stuff. You ever heard a preacher say that to you in your life? It is not bad. We always come into church and we feel bad, right? We feel bad about wanting a comfortable home. We feel bad about wanting a nice car that actually runs from point A to point B without us having to pour a gallon of oil into the engine just to get it to run. We feel bad about that stuff. We feel bad if somebody looks at our stuff and it's nicer than their stuff. We feel bad about that. We feel bad if we want nice shoes. We feel bad if we want nice clothes, right? We feel bad about all that stuff. Why? Because mammon is talking to us through money and it's keeping us in bondage and in fear. God says, seek me first. It doesn't matter. I'll get you this stuff. I'll get you the home. I'll get you the food. I'll get you the clothes. Just seek me first. I'll get it to you. I know what you need. And he says, on top of that, delight yourself in me. You know when you delight yourself in the Lord, your delight is not in things. Within those desires of your heart, God will give them to you. God will blow you away with the things that he brings in your life that you say, man, I just had a little dream in my heart to have a nice house. And look at the house that God gave me. My goodness. And then the praise will go to God and not to you because you're delighting yourself in the Lord, right? We hold everything loosely. We hold everything loosely. See, money in itself is not bad. If it was, then Jesus would have never handled money. But Jesus had a treasurer that traveled with him. If money in itself was bad, Jesus would not have had a treasurer working with him and walking around with him. Secondly, when Peter came up and he said, hey, they're complaining about you not paying the temple tax, Jesus would not have told Peter what he told him and then went and told Peter, go fishing and you'll find a coin in the fish's mouth and you pay your tax and my tax. See, what would Jesus have said? Jesus said, we don't have to pay taxes. Money's evil. Don't touch it. God has no problem with you having money. God has a problem with money having you. Come on, somebody. Are you listening today? See, mammon will try and get our eyes off of God and onto money. Mammon will get you worried. It will get you distracted until it destroys you with worry and fear. It will paralyze you. How many of you us have said this? Okay, let me just prove this point. How many of us said this? If I only had a little bit more. Come on, you can finish that sentence, can't you? You can finish that sentence. Let's try it. If I only had a little bit more money, right? Okay. Let's break this thing down for a second. Study done by Boston College entitled The Joys and Dilemmas of Wealth, which surveyed the super rich with at least $25 million in assets. They found that the rich worry about money as much as, if not more than, those who don't have wealth or money. They worried about these things, okay? They worried about how money affected their work. Think about this. They come into millions of dollars, and all of a sudden somebody tells them, that's great. You don't have to work anymore, right? We would all say, amen, hallelujah. You know what they said? Oh, no. My identity is wrapped up in what I do. If I don't work anymore, then who am I? And all of a sudden, they start to worry. How is money affecting my work, who I am? They worry about how money affects their relationships. Is this person a real friend, or are they just using me for my money? See, all of a sudden, mammon's talking to them. They're worried about relationships. Are these people coming into my life because they're expecting me to give them something? I can't even give a gift, because if I don't give them a good gift, they're going to think that I'm being stingy and cheap. Last year, I gave them a car, and this year, if I give them a gift basket, my goodness, they're going to hate me, right? All of a sudden, mammon is talking to them. They worry about how it's going to affect their family relationships, how their kids are going to turn out. I don't want my child to become a trust fund brat. I want them to value a dollar and hard work and that sort of a thing. And they're worried about how money's going to affect their relationships. They worry about money. And listen to this. Most of them believe that if they just, oh, this blows my mind. Most of them believe that if they just, oh, come on. You know where this is going, don't you? Most of them believe that if they just had 25% more, that they would be financially stable. I'm sorry. You have $25 million in assets, and you're looking for $6,250,000 more to be financially stable. When you got $25 million in assets, what is $6,250,000 going to do for your life? Right? It's easy to judge them, though, isn't it? Because we don't deal with those numbers. And yet, percentage-wise, we do the very same thing. I think that's why Matthew chapter 6 ends talking about worry, and then Matthew chapter 7 starts out with, judge not lest ye be judged. Because we judge others about money. We judge others about worry, and yet we are bound by it ourselves. See, We think that money can solve our problems, but money cannot solve any problems. Have you noticed that? Jesus, when he was traveling around, never said, you know what your problem is? You need more money. Never. Never. When Jesus was walking through the crowd, right, and the woman with the issue, the problem of blood for 12 years, came up behind him and touched the hem of his garment, he didn't whip around and say, hey, here's $100. I hope everything works out because that's what you needed. You needed some more money. He didn't say that. What did he say? He said, you need your sins forgiven. You need to be healed. You need to be delivered. You need the wisdom of God. You need to sell everything you have. You need to come follow me. See, Jesus is the answer to every problem, because if it's a problem that can be solved by money, it's not a problem. My goodness. If all it is about money, then let's just go get more money. Because if that's the answer to the problem, if that's the solution, just go get the money. You don't need Jesus if it's solved by money. But see, if it can't be solved by money, then it's a real problem, and then we need Jesus. And Jesus is the ultimate answer. He is the problem solver. He solves in himself every problem humanity has. So worry comes on us. Mammon is talking to us. Worry is Mammon's way of distracting our attention from the Word of God and getting us to focus on money. Mark chapter 4, turn there with me. Jesus is talking about the parable of the sower in Mark chapter 4. He starts talking about the word that's sown. He says the sower that sows the word is the Spirit of God, right? And here comes the sower sowing the word, and some of it falls by the wayside, right? And the birds of the air, the devil comes in and steals that word away before people can understand it, before they can really grasp it. Some of it falls among the stony ground, the shallow ground, right? And when the sun rises, the persecutions for the word's sake arise day by day. The heat comes on. It doesn't have any root in itself, and therefore it withers and it dies. And then he starts to talk about there was some seed that was sown in ground that it was able to take root, but then thorns grew up and thistles grew up and started to choke the word so that it became unfruitful. In Mark chapter 4, he starts to give the explanation of this parable. And here he comes and he starts talking about what's really going on. In Mark chapter 4, in verse number 19, look at what it says in Mark chapter 4, verse number 19. He starts talking about the seed that's sown among thistles and thorns. Mark chapter 4, 19, he says, in the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things entering in choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. Now, up on the overheads, I have highlighted a couple of words that I want to point out for you. So if you would give your attention up here at the overhead screens, it says, in the cares of this world. Everybody say cares. That word cares is the same word that we found in Matthew chapter 6 called worry. It literally means to shatter, to disrupt, or to break apart and distract from, and to give attention to divided interests. That's really what this word is really talking about. So he says, the cares of this world. In other words, when cares come on your life, when worry comes on your life, it breaks apart your faith. It divides your heart and your loyalty, and it takes you away from God, and it takes you to the things of this world that you're worried about. And then look at what happens, the deceitfulness of riches. Here comes Mammon talking to you about your life. See, you've got that shattered, distracted interest and attention. All of a sudden, wealth comes in and tells you, if you only had more money. Mammon will come talking to you, right? Here comes George on the dollar bill. Hey, come get some more of me. Come find my buddy Ben. Take a look. Is Alexander around? Is Lincoln around, right? Can you find Honest Abe anywhere around? See why? Because it's coming and it's deceiving you. It's lying to you that if you only had some more money, you would be okay. So the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and look, and then the desires for other things entering in. Desiring other things than God's provision, than God's hand, than God's spirit, than God's presence. No, I need a better car. Oh, I need a better job. Oh, I need a better life. I need a better this. I need a better that. And all of a sudden, look, what these things entering in choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. When our attention and our interest is distracted, shattered, broken apart from the things of God, and all of a sudden we start to worry, then the deceitfulness of wealth comes in. You know what the deceitfulness of wealth really is? The deceitfulness of wealth is that it is a legitimate concern. It's legitimate. You need food, because if you don't eat, you're going to die, right? You need clothes, because walking around naked, everybody's going to think you're weird. You know what I'm saying? They'll lock you up and put a towel on you or something. They're legitimate concerns. God knows that you have need of these things. They're things that God put in place. But I want you to turn me to Luke chapter 12. Remember last time we got together, we talked about Luke chapter number 12 in the first part, talking about the heart. And while you turn there, I want to make this statement. If we can keep our eyes on Jesus, we will not worry about money. That's what this is really all about today, is that worry will try and distract us. But if we can keep our eyes on Jesus, then we will not worry about money. Well, let's chop it up. In Luke chapter number 12, we're going to start in verse number 22, and we're going to read through verse number 32. Luke chapter 12, verse number 22, look at what it says. Then he said to his disciples, stop right there for a second, look up at me, okay? It says, then he, capital H, this is Jesus, right? Jesus is speaking to the people. He's in the midst of a crowd. He just had somebody stand up in the midst of this crowd while he was teaching and say, teacher, tell my brother to give me some money, right? Tell him to divide the inheritance. Jesus says, nah, I'm not doing that. I'm not your judge. I'm not your arbitrator. Then he puts the guy on blast and he tells everybody, watch out for greediness, right? You guys remember this? Then he tells a parable about somebody who is rich towards himself rather than being rich towards God. He builds barns. He builds storehouses. He kicks back. He says, I've got it going on. And then what happens? He dies. He only got to enjoy that blessing for one day, and God called him a fool. And so now Jesus says this. He said to his disciples, therefore, in other words, because of what I just said about being rich towards God rather than being greedy and selfish towards yourself, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, nor about the body, what you will put on. Life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. You know, he just identified male and female right there. You didn't see it, did you? He just said, women and men, don't worry. Why? Because women are more worried about what they're going to wear and what people are going to think about what they look like, and men are more worried about what we're going to eat. Let me prove this to you. I'll use myself as an example. I needed some shirts because it's getting hot, right? And so I told my wife, honey, I need to go shopping. I need to buy some short sleeve shirts that I can wear, things that'll look nice at work, things that I can wear in the pulpit. So I went down to the desert to the outlet stores, right? I hit up every outlet store in that mall that had men's clothing in it in 1.5 hours, okay? In that 1.5 hours, I found every $8 shirt that I could find, and I bought it. I came out with 7 shirts, one for every day of the week, right? I bought 5 blue shirts and 2 white ones just to mix it up, right? Because you need a little bit of color in your wardrobe. In fact, this is one of them. Praise the Lord. Looking good, yeah? But just the other day on my way home, I hadn't eaten well. I'd been eating junk all day. It was National Donut Day on Friday, and they brought donuts into the staff lounge. And don't you know, it wasn't the spirit of mammon. It was the spirit of donut was talking to me. And it said, come and find an old-fashioned maple, Pastor Dan. And I just started walking like a zombie over into the staff lounge because I had to get a donut on National Donut Day. And I ate that whole donut like it was going out of style. This is the last donut that you're ever going to see. There will never be another maple glazed old-fashioned donut ever again. And so I horked it down, if you will. And I started feeling sick. And then for lunch, I had fast food. And I was driving home. And on the way home, my wife said, hey, we're going to have some friends over to the house. I said, that's great. She said, can you pick up some pizzas? I said, that's fine. I will pick up some pizzas. But I have been eating junk all day. Do we have a salad in the refrigerator? And she was in the middle of a conversation with somebody else. And I made her leave that conversation to go to our refrigerator and find out if the salad had been expired yet. Because I was worried about what I was going to eat. You say, well, Pastor, you can afford to eat some junk. Listen, this does not happen by accident, you guys. Just yesterday, we had one of our biggest days. We were busy all day long. I preached in the morning. We had the back-to-school bash in the afternoon. I went to my daughter's ballet recital, and then we're on our way home. And I said, honey, there is not a single fruit or vegetable in the entire house. We better go over to the grocery store right now and get some. And she's going, I'm tired. I want to go home. Can't you just microwave something? I said, no, I need a fruit or a vegetable, woman. And I made her go to the store, and I made her buy some fruits and vegetables. Praise God. See, women, you're thinking about what are they going to think? If I go out, does this make me look fat, right? Is this really what I want? See, you're worried. Jesus says, don't worry about what you're going to wear. Don't worry about what you're going to eat, men. Life is more than food. The body's more than clothing. Verse 24, look at what he says. He says, consider. Verse 24, consider the ravens. For they neither sow nor reap, which have neither storehouses nor barns, and God feeds them, of how much more value are you than the birds? Didn't Jesus die for you? You think he's not going to feed you? Didn't God feed Adam and Eve in the garden before there ever was paper money or coins? Look at what he goes on to say. He says, and which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature? Cubit's about 18 inches. It was the length of a man's arm from his elbow up here to his hand. So which of you by worrying can grow about this much? Anybody in this place? Oh, I'm just so afraid and terrified of what's going to happen to the economy. It doesn't happen, does it? Which of you by worrying can add one cubit 18 inches to his stature? And then he goes on and look at what he says. He says in verse number 26, if you then are not able to do the least, why are you anxious for the rest? Why are you worrying? Why do you care about those things? Verse 27, consider, once again, he says, think about it. Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If God then so clothes the grass, which today is in the field and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? Notice Jesus said, that's little faith. That is little faith. When you can't believe God for the basic essentials of life and you're worried about what you're going to eat or what you're going to wear, that is little faith. He said, look up to the ravens and see that God provides for them. Look down to the earth and see that God provides for the flowers of the field. He says, look without, look at your clothing, what's outside, what you can control. The things that you can control, listen, don't worry about the things that you can control. You can control those things, right? You decide what you put on, you decide what you can wear, and God will clothe you. But he says, look within, look at what you put inside of your body and what you eat and what you can't control, how your body receives that food. And he says, God's got that under control too. You don't need to worry about a thing, because if you look up, there's God. If you look down, there's God. If you look without, there's God. If you look within, there's God. God has got it under control. Come on, somebody praise the Lord for that. When we worry about these things, he says, oh, you of little faith. Four times in the Gospels, you find Jesus telling somebody they don't have that much faith. He calls them, oh, you of little faith. First time is when Jesus is sleeping in the boat. The disciples are panicking. They're freaking out. Jesus, don't you care that we're going to die? He stands up. He rebukes the waves and the wind. It's calm. And he says, why did you worry, oh, you of little faith? See, when we're worried about surrounding circumstances and tumultuous times, it's little faith. Here's Peter walking to Jesus on the water. He's got his eyes fixed on Jesus. He's the only man that ever stepped out in faith other than Jesus on the waters. Peter is going for it. But all of a sudden, he looks out. Once again, he gets his eyes off Jesus, and he gets it onto the wind and the waves that are boisterous, and he starts to sink, and he cries out, Jesus, save me. And immediately Jesus grabs his hand and lifts him up out of the water, and he says, why did you doubt, oh, you of little faith? Next time we see this, here's the disciples. They're traveling with Jesus, and as they're traveling with Jesus, Jesus stops to warn them about something. He says, boys, listen up. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. And they start to talk amongst themselves, and they say, Jesus is talking about bread. Did you bring the bread? I didn't bring the bread. I thought you were going to bring the bread. Wait a second. Peter, didn't you get the bread? No, I told Andrew to get the bread. And all of a sudden, there's all this talk about bread. And what does Jesus say? Jesus said, wait a second. Are you guys really talking about bread right now? Don't you remember that I fed the 5,000 with five loaves and two fishes? Don't you remember the 4,000 that I fed? Come on. I'm not talking about bread here, guys. Oh, you of little faith. See, when we start looking for provision rather than looking to Jesus, it's, oh, you of little faith. And now here in Luke chapter 12, when we start to worry about our life, what we will wear, what we will eat, all of a sudden we realize we're distracted, and our faith that was great at one point in Jesus, we've got our eyes off Jesus. And now he says, oh, you of little faith. Anybody getting something yet? Let's go on. Verse 29. And do not seek. Everybody say, do not seek. Do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink, nor have an anxious mind. Verse 30. For all these things the nation of the world seeks after. Everybody out there in the world seeking after these things. Culturally, socially, it's easy to get into the slipstream, isn't it? Because we're bombarded by it every day. Drive down the freeways, you've got it on billboards, you've got it on the radio, you've got it on the television. Your cell phone's talking to you about stuff. constantly. You can't even go to the grocery store without a little divider that divides your food from someone else's food without having an advertisement on it anymore. Go to the gas station to get gas, and there's a television talking to you about what your life needs to be like. It's easy to fall into the slipstream of what the world is doing, but look at what it goes on in the rest of the verse. And your Father knows that you need these things. God knows. God knows you need to be clothed. God knows you need to be fed. God fed Adam and Eve, but listen, didn't God clothe Adam and Eve? Oh my goodness. Verse 31, but seek. Everybody say, but seek. See, we're not to seek the things of this world, but we are to seek something else. But seek the kingdom of God. Matthew, the 6th chapter, says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. But seek the kingdom of God and all these things, the provisions, the clothing, the food, your basic necessities of life, all these things will be added to you. Verse 32, do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the stuff. Is that what it says? No, it doesn't say the stuff, right? It's your Father's good pleasure to give you the clothes. No, it doesn't say that. It's your Father's good pleasure to give you the food, the car, the house. No, it's your Father's good pleasure to give you something far greater than clothing and food and housing and little basic necessities. God wants to give you something greater. God wants to bless your socks off. God wants to give you something that will blow your mind. It is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom of God itself. And with the kingdom comes every resource, every asset. But guess what else comes with the kingdom? Right there, the first four letters of that word. With the kingdom comes the King, Jesus. He is right there with you because there is no kingdom without King Jesus. It's your Father's good pleasure. Get your eyes off of the stuff and get your eyes on Jesus. So how do we use money? If mammon in itself is a spirit that rests on money, how do we use money? Here's how we use it. You give the tithe, and then you look to God. It doesn't get any easier, guys. This is not rocket science. This is as deep as we're going today. You give your tithe, and then you look to God. You want to give God an offering? You want to be generous? Go ahead. Look to God. If God speaks to you about bringing something greater, bring something greater, because God's obviously got a plan in place. God wants to do something in your life. You just need to trust him and follow him. Give the tithe, give what God tells you to give, bring it here into the storehouse of God, and then look to God for your needs. God will supply all of your needs by his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. You have a desire in your heart, you want to do something, look to God. Bring the tithe, bring your offering, give to God. We give the tithe and we look to God. It's that simple. God wants you to do what he has called you to do. As you do this, it will break the spirit of mammon off of your finances. Because now, when you give that 10% to God, what does he say? He says, I will bless the 90% that's left over. It's all mine, but I'm going to allow you to use that 90%. But that 90% now doesn't have the spirit of mammon resting on it. It has the spirit of God resting on it. Because the blessing, the capacity of God to succeed is upon your finances. And now, mammon won't be talking to you. The spirit of God will be talking to you about how to use your money, how to be a steward, how to invest, how to build the kingdom of God and seek first the kingdom of God. God will be talking to you. We look to God as our provider, not money, not man, not a job, not a government, not an institution. We look to God and we steward the rest. Luke chapter 12, verse 33 and 34. Sell what you have and give alms. Provide yourself money bags which do not grow old, a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches nor moth destroys. Verse 34, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Follow the money, find the heart. Where is your care? Follow the money, find the heart. Where is your care? I want to wrap this thing up today with a story of a great lady in our church, one of our wonderful members for a long time. Her and her husband are great people. Just awesome. Love them so much. They have a daughter who's about ready to go into college, and they were concerned about how they were going to pay for college. It's a growing concern in our nation. They didn't want to get in debt. They didn't want to have student loans. So they had a plan. He was a member of our armed services, and so he had the GI Bill. He knew that if he had signed up for a certain amount of time, that he was going to be able to transfer that GI Bill from himself to his daughter. And so he had that plan in place. Had to be signed up for 20 years, and then he'll be able to transfer it over. So here they are, and they start praying about colleges. They start to tour colleges. They find one that they like, Christian University in the area, and they're so excited about it. They believe that they had the peace of God on the decision. So they start to move forward. They get the application, and she gets accepted, all that good stuff. And so he goes down to the VA office to get his benefits, and he decides, you know what, I want to transfer my GI Bill benefits for college over to my daughter for her schooling. And they said, that's great. You got the 20 years, but you're supposed to sign up for 20 years and then re-enlist for another 4 years, and then after that 4 years, you will get the benefits. Benefit of the GI Bill. Their whole plan was shattered right there. And worry, anxiety, fear just started to grip her heart. Listen to what she writes me. She wrote me an email about this, and she said this. She says, as I was talking to God and asking desperately with so much worry and heaviness in my heart how we were going to do this, I heard him speak so gently to my heart. Your trust all this time has been on the GI Bill. I want you to put your trust in me. I will provide. Don't worry. She says, I felt so sad because I didn't realize that I had put God on the back burner in this area of our finances. I had to ask him to forgive me for not trusting him first. Then I had to make the change in my heart and consciously shift my heart to trust in God to move a mountain. Then she writes, praise God, the mountain has begun to move. All the glory to him and not the GI Bill. She went on to tell me the rest of the story in person. She said that her daughter ended up getting an academic scholarship because she's very smart, and it paid for half of the amount of what she needed. And she said, I know the rest is covered. God's going to do something. She's going to get a job. She'll get some provision is coming, and she's trusting in God. She ends with this. Thank God for his love and mercy to us, for loving reminding us to focus back on him. Today, I wonder if you've been weighed down with cares. Wonder if today your faith has been shattered and mammon has been talking to you, deceiving you because it's a legitimate concern. Wonder today how many of you are bound by things and you've got suffocation going on in your life where stuff is suffocating your faith. Today, that's going to change. We're going to pray and we're going to break that off of each and every one of you. Let's pray today. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I lift up to you each and every one of these saints in this place, God. All of us, Lord, have the propensity to get distracted, to get detoured and get off faith, to allow the word to be choked by things and cares and distractions and things that you never wanted us to worry about, God. Lord, today we take our eyes off of those things and we shift our eyes off the stuff. We shift our eyes and our focus onto you. God, today we're ready to pour into what it is that you would have us to do. God, we'll give our tithe, we'll bring our offerings, Lord, and we'll look to you. We thank you, God, that you're going to provide for things. God, you know we have need of those things. God, you know how also you're going to get them to us. But Lord, we say today by faith, we trust you. Come on, somebody say, I trust you, Lord. I trust you, Lord. I trust you, Lord. However many times you got to say it, say, I trust you, Lord. Father, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody in agreement said, amen. Amen.